wonder if somebody could come up and make a character. No. We certainly couldn't. Somebody's pride and joy, yeah?
Aye, 15 years ago.
The steering lock. It's worked well, isn't it? Satellite dish.
We've got a frying pan now.
There's still a front wheel on it.
Still got a steering lock and all.
Ugh, guy. He caught a pain, it'll be right as rain.
Clyde Fire Training Centre. Halfway through a 12-week course to become firefighters, trainees Sharon Caldwell and Ian McCready have learnt all about ladders and hoses, and are finally getting a chance to handle the heavy machinery.
Everyone's been really looking forward to it. On Monday we were all sitting through there, can't wait to smash windows, can't wait to cut up cars, you know, it sounds really sad. You go home at night and tell people, guess what I did today, I've smashed every window in a car, you know, cutting up cars. It's not many people go home and say that they do that, but you must be the saddest that enjoy it.
Tomorrow they will begin car crash rescue scenarios. But tonight, they're having a squad night out.
He's all coming for one, aye.
Then we're going for a drink.
A drink, then. I don't know.
It's the start of the night shift for Maryhill's Red Watch. And firefighter Gordy Cameron has learnt about a possible surprise inspection.
You'll find out later. Find out later when you're in the station office.
Gary's scared to stand up to him, so he's away on the shaving now. Gary, be brave. Leave a wee go to a wee ming. Did you spot?
All right, wee man.
How you doing?
You shave?
That's good. Yeah,
that's a lovely shave. Look at that. Shave a brown ball.
Watch manager Thomas Kerr's surprise inspection has been successfully foiled.
Don't even think you're doing that. In. It's a professional. In.
And they're now ready to get down to business.
Jake, now we're talking.
I could fit that in.
That saves mine.
Swiss roll, remember Swiss rolls?
Swiss rolls.
Turn me on.
You're just an animal, you.
There's 17 people in that.
Can you shave? Don't go there.
I joined the fire brigade to go to fires, put out fires and deal with incidents. That's definitely what I like best about the job. Obviously the camera I do with the guys, but it's definitely better to have a busy night to get out and about and do things. Gets the night in quicker and definitely helps the watch as well, you know, it gets the bond you all as well when you're doing these kind of things together.
You never shaved yesterday. When Tam left the TV room, you went,
I've no shave.
I managed to beat Tam's thing.
Down the pub, and Sharon and the guys are clearly enjoying the break.
Oh, you're a top banana.
Get Cotton Eye Joan.
Cotton Eye Joan.
I don't always come just now and again. I'm not in with the heavy drinkers here, you know.
Right from the start, everyone in our squad just gelled really well and got on really well, and they just treat me as one of the guys, and that's the way I want to be treated. Everyone brings different experiences to the job, and that can only help when you're working with the public, because the public are all different.
Always ready.
As the trainees drink on into the night, it seems Gordy Cameron could be lucky with his hopes for a busy shift.
That's been a fire in the East End. We're heading over as a relief crew. Don't know what we're going to yet, we'll find out when we get there. So we'll be there for the next probably 4 or 5 hours. And then we'll get relieved by another crew. Take over from us. So as I say, we'll find out when we get there. First arrival at a job, you can usually tell by the extent of the smoke coming out of the building, whether it's serious or not. Obviously, if it's really serious, you'll get flames coming out the windows as well, but you get a wee buzz.
East End Sawmill has been ablaze for 4 hours. The aerial platform, known as the Alp, has managed to contain the fire, but safety precautions have prevented crews entering the building so far. But now the roof has collapsed. The crews outside are struggling to hose the blaze, and it's decided to send the Maryhill crew inside to extinguish the fire head on.
Definitely get an adrenaline buzz going into a building. Time slows down a wee bit, you know, everything becomes more focused. You start to notice the things that you need to notice, everything else, you maybe get a bit of tunnel vision. You sharpen your senses and things, you know. You don't actually think of the danger, you don't think of what could happen to you and what you're going to lose if anything happens to you. It's not that kind of feeling you get at all.
Crew are unable to reach the seat of the fire and must therefore tackle it from a distance.
What we're going to do is put two jets in this door.
I think we'll only need the one, won't we? Do you want the 70 or the 45?
70 will do.
We'll keep the 70.
Aye.
Right. We're going to be fighting the fire from here. At the moment they've got an aerial up, and what they're doing is fighting the fire from above. So what we're going to do is we're going to have one length of jet coming from here, and we'll fight the fire from here. It's just a big bonfire at the moment, and that's that.
Because there's a lot of things in the way, we'll struggle probably. Obviously the Alps not really hitting much, everything seems to be covered now, and the Alps just hitting top of the roof. But if we can manage to get this bit out, we'll be able to work our way across to the bit that's going over on the other side. Because of the way it's collapsed, everything's really burning underneath all the sheets of wood, so the only way we're going to hit them is to move all the wood, but it's a bit dangerous to go in there now because there's a wall ready to come down any minute. But if we put the Alp up, it's not really hitting them, it's just hitting the top of the sheets as well, so eventually we'll need to get them moved.
While Gordy Cameron tackles the sawmill, the other Gordy, firefighter McDermott, is responding to the second car fire of the night. Strathclyde crews attend an average of 5 car fires a day, every day of the year. And 4 out of 5 are considered to be malicious.
Car seems to have been burning for a while before we got here anyway. You can see it's quite well gone. All the tyres and everything are melted. We're just trying to get underneath now, just to get the last of it extinguished. Joyriders usually steal a car then set fire to it, you know? Another one for the insurance company.
I'd like to get the boot and the bonnet off, just to see if there's anything in the boot that's still burning that we can't see properly.
Bodies.
And obviously...
if there's any bodies in the boot.
Yeah. Your battery and everything like that, they need to make sure it's stopped burning.
there is risks involved, just with petrol tanks and things, and sometimes you can put water on them and the things will explode. You get tyres popping.
I wasn't able to sleep anyway. That too much energy coursing through my veins through that lasagna and chocolate cake. I feel a midnight workout coming on.
At the sawmill, the fire is still well alight. Fallen debris continues to prevent Redwatch from fighting the fire head-on. The danger of walls collapsing is escalating, and the crew are forced to withdraw. After 3.5 hours firefighting, a relief crew has arrived, and Redwatch can return to station.
Wet, cold, tired. And the fire's still no out. Ready for my bed ran off. It's 4:15. Head back to the station, get back there, cleaned up, 5 o'clock. Chances of a sleep are pretty remote. Maybe grab a couple of hours with a bit of luck. Chances are we'll get a turnout in half an hour's time. Spoil the rest of the night.
Good as new.
Bad thing. Gonna wake up Big Gordon and tell him I'm safe. People do have an opinion about the fire brigade, which has came to the fore over the last few years, I suppose, with our strikes and things. People think we've got snooker tables and we just sit and watch telly and play snooker all night and then go to our bed. But through the night, if you can grab 2 or 3 hours sleep, surely it's more beneficial. If somebody's a fire that you've had a bit of a rest rather than been up all night and going to a fire where you're maybe mentally tired and physically tired.
I just wish you would sleep closer sometimes. They should get double beds.
And just when they think the hard work is done for the night...
for the grand total of about 90 seconds. It's high flats. There's a fire in the stairs on the 13th floor.
Any feeling of tiredness the crew might have had has evaporated. Fire may look insignificant from the outside, but the crew have no idea if it has spread internally.
Somebody's carry out.
Aye,
aye. What are you driving here? Kind of rubbish here, and some person set it on fire and smoked it right up the whole staircase, the full length of the flats. So we've had to ventilate in every floor, let the smoke out. Could have been a lot worse. Luckily, all the doors in each landing were shut, or the smoke would have been right in the landings. People in the houses then would have been affected, but the doors were all shut, so the smoke just went straight up the staircase. Once we've opened all the doors, it's went out in the landings. Right, take these off.
Down the road, it looked quite impressive, coming out the window, but when we got up there, it was just literally the window that was on fire, that was about it. Obviously, there was plenty of smoke right enough, but fortunately, it wasn't hitting all the landings where the houses were.
Although most people see firefighters as a valued and essential public service, there are those who consider the crews a valid target for abuse and physical attacks. At Strathclyde Fire Headquarters, Chief Officer Brian Sweeney is well aware of the problem facing firefighters. Today, he's due to visit a school in Parkhead, where children have made a video about the importance of respecting the service.
We'd first started recording attacks on crews about 4 years ago, I think 2001-2 were the first recorded statistics, and there was a steady increase up to last year. Last year, we actually seen the first recorded decrease, although it was only slight, but it did offer some hope. Sadly, this year, the attacks on crews are back up, so we're doing everything we can to try and get to the root of why people think it's smart to do that. And I think we do need to start with education. We need to start with kids, and that's really what this morning is trying to focus on. Feeling a little bit under the weather today. Clearly, if I was a woman, this would be a minor sniffle. But being a man, as I am, I have the most chronic man flu, which is debilitating. Actually, no, I have a minor sniffle, and it's making my voice sound a wee bit hoarse. Good as well at Parkhead, the station, getting involved, Alan, you know, to the extent that they'll be starting to get some feedback now from this stuff, saying, actually, community safety's pretty good. Yeah, interested to look at how the kids who have made it and starred in it have their perspective about how they feel about open fire hydrants or vandalism or attacks on fire crews. It'd be really interesting just to see their view on things. And this is one of many initiatives, but, you know, again, we find ourselves lamenting the fact that more and more people who work in the fire and rescue service are being... Do I just cut that? So we won't do the bell. What does the bell mean? Is that you going for break?
Setting bell.
Setting bell, is it? Okay.
Okay. Before we start, can you give me your name and what age you are?
I'm called Lisa Thompson and I'm 10 years old.
Okay, tell me a little bit about this film.
Well, it's about attacking fire crews that is wrong and it could be putting people's life at risk.
Perfect, well done.
Well done, lady.
Look out!
Stop!
Attacking fire crew, that's what we
quite.
What are you doing that for?
Because it's just for a buzz, man, it's cool.
Stop!
What are you doing?
Attacking the fire crew.
What are you trying to do?
A job.
He's trying to do your job and you're trying to hit him.
What we're really doing here is placing some investment for a future generation. Kids are labelled with everything these days, you know, kids, 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 this generation. It's only a small minority of kids. The vast majority of kids love the Fire and Rescue Service, think we're fantastic and we have no issue with them. But a small minority of kids seem to think that we're fair game. So if we can, let's get to the kids early and teach them just what it means to attack a firefighter, but maybe more importantly, what the consequences of that could be.
The trainees are about to begin a major road crash exercise.
Two crews will arrive, and then another two crews will come increments of 2 minutes afterwards. Casualties will be Caldwell and McCready. First crew and second crew, will you go to your pumps and just check your equipment just now?
Going to be a casualty and an RTC. Nothing down to my own driving, obviously. It's been somebody's placed a car like that.
Yeah, looking forward to being the casualties to see how it actually feels, what it sounds like. Hopefully it means that when you're doing the job as well, you're not going to appreciate the injuries or the pain or the real fear that someone's in, but hopefully it'll help you in a way to kind of understand what it feels like.
It is actually quite scary because lying here, you are lying thinking that everything's going to come down on you. I suppose you wouldn't know at that point, would you? You would be unconscious.
Fire service here. Try not to move your head. We'll be with you as soon as we possibly can. We'll get you out of there.
It's OK, mate. Firefighter, rescue you in a minute.
Stabilisation complete at this side. Have we got a pulse? Casualties airway clear.